Hi, my name is Don Bolt. I'm the pastor at Henrietta Christian Fellowship, and welcome to the 10-minute video summary of the message from December 8th, 2013. And hey, happy Advent, okay? So we're going to get right underway. Father, thank you for this opportunity to share this message one more time through the wonder of electronic media. Father, we pray that you'd bless people, Lord God, as they hear it. In Jesus' name. Amen. Well, you know, we've been talking about prayer, and so we've been working through this list of different ways of how we pray, and this is how we pray number five. Okay, so we're talking about the prayer of agreement, and the prayer of agreement really, you know, that whole term actually comes from a scripture over in Matthew 18, 19 through 20, and it says this: again, I say to you, this is Jesus speaking, that if two of you agree on earth about anything that they may ask, it shall be done for them by my Father who is in heaven. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, I am in their midst, okay? And this has been used as the basis for this whole idea of the prayer of agreement, okay? And giving it a name, that sort of thing. But, you know, if you take a look at the context, you quickly become aware that what was being discussed here was church discipline, okay? And is talking about just, you know, if a person sins and is confronted multiple times and won't repent, there came a point where the elders of the church, the leaders of the church, would decide to put that person out of the church and treat them like a stranger. And then this then is what follows. Is again, I say to you that if you agree about this, you know, that what you've bound here or loosed here on earth, the same thing will be done in heaven. And so, you know, this is probably not a good scripture to use when we're trying to establish the basis for the prayer of agreement. But let me make one thing clear. That is that there's plenty of other places in the scripture that talks about people agreeing together in prayer. There's plenty of places in the scripture where you see that the early church, they agreed in prayer. Okay, so I mean, the prayer of agreement is an important part of our, you know, prayer together. And, you know, just those times when we can just really empty ourselves out of anything else and just get ourselves focused in on speaking our hearts together to Jesus. You know, but the thing that's important is that this word for agreement here is the Greek word symphonia. In other words, the original language of the New Testament, it was symphonia. You know, this idea of being in harmony together. And if you're going to pray in harmony, you got to be in harmony, okay? And so a lot of the chapter, what it's talking about is how to be in harmony, okay? So we're going to take a little bit of time and work our way through the chapter and just start to understand some of these things, okay? The chapter starts in verse 1 with a question. At that time, the disciples came to Jesus and said, "Who is greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" I mean, I know that Jesus got frustrated with his disciples. And, you know, this question about who's going to be the greatest, you know, I think that was one of the ones that just was pure frustration, you know, because they kept, you know, wanting to compete with each other for this place at his side in the kingdom of heaven. So what Jesus responds to them, and what he does is he calls a child to himself, all right? And he takes that child and he sets that child before them. And this is what he says: "Truly, I say to you, unless you are converted and become like children, you will not even enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever then humbles himself as this child, he is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. And whoever receives such a child in my name receives me." And so, you know, it goes on then to talk about, you know, this humble way of being a part of God's kingdom. Not prideful, humble, okay? That this is the way to be, all right? And so this whole idea that starts to unfold after it is about being aware, beware of offenses, beware of stumbling blocks, and you know, these opportunities for us to fall into disharmony and or to fall into sin in other ways, you know, to beware of these things. And Matthew 18:6 says this: "But whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to stumble, it would be better for him to have a heavy millstone hung around his neck and to be drowned in the depth of the sea." I remember that there's somebody that I actually know, a guy by the name of John Bevere, and he wrote a book called Bait of Satan. And what the book was about, which is an important subject for us as believers, is just, you know, what to do about offenses. You know, that a lot of people, you know, things are done to them, they take on an offense, okay, and that becomes a problem because they carry this offense around. And I remember it became a very popular teaching, and we did a lot of teaching on it in a place where I was before. And at some point, somebody said, "Hey, do you think we should teach that course again?" And anyways, I said, "Well, if we're going to teach that, we should probably teach the other book." They said, "What book is that?" I said, "Well, I'm figuring that a book this good has been written about taking offense. We probably should write a book to all the people that are causing the offenses, okay? Because if that course, was as popular as it was every single time. Lots and lots of people signing up because they had taken offense over something. I think it was probably about time to start talking to the offenders because, you know, in our midst, you know, we need to value living in harmony. We need to value not causing offense, all right? Not taking offense is another thing. We should be quick to forgive, but I think that we should also be quick to ask forgiveness when we realize we may have caused somebody to stumble. We may have given a stumbling block to somebody, okay? And so the chapter goes on to give some advice, and I'm just going to summarize it here. Don't cause people to stumble, point number one, okay? Don't cause people to stumble. Point number two, don't keep anything in your life that causes you to stumble. And by inference, live in a way that keeps you from stumbling. And take some time to go over to 2 Peter chapter 1 and read right on through, and you'll get to chapter 1, verse 10. And it says, therefore, brethren, be all the more diligent to make certain about his calling and choosing you. For as long as you practice these things, and there had been earlier in the chapter a list of things for us to be practicing in order to grow as followers of Christ. It says, for if, okay, listen to this, okay? It says, for if you do these things, you will never stumble. Third thing, do not look down on people who seem less than you. God cares for them in extraordinary ways, okay? And so don't look down on people who seem less than you. I mean, if anything, you know how this tendency is that we walk into a room and we look for the best. We look for our best friends. We look for those that we think most of and are drawn to them. But the Word would encourage us that when we walk into a room, perhaps what we need to do is seek out those that are least likely to be greeted, least likely to be valued and encouraged, and make sure that we do greet, welcome, and encourage those people. And I said earlier today, now if I make you the first person I approach in the room, that's not because I think of you as the least among us, okay? All right, so then it goes on to another final point here. Don't allow stumbling blocks to multiply in our midst, okay? If there are things that we are saying, doing, or practicing, you know, and those things are causing people to stumble or to be tripped up, you know, or to be undervalued, for us not to be able to live in harmony, don't let those things multiply. Let's deal with the stuff, get it out in the open, and get it out of the way. And so let's take a second look at Matthew 18, 19 through 20. Again, I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything that they may ask, it shall be done for them by my Father who is in heaven. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, I am there in their midst. Christ is in our midst whenever we gather. Christ is very present in the church to save. Listen to these two verses, verse 11 and 14 from that chapter. Verse 11, for the Son of Man has come to save that which was lost. God is calling in among us, if we're a good church, he's calling in among us those that need to be saved. He's seeking and saving those who are lost. Verse 14, so it is not the will of your Father who is in heaven that one of these little ones perish, okay? And James 5, 19 through 20 says this, my brethren, if any among you strays from the truth and one turns him back, let him know that he who turns a sinner from the error of his way will save his soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins. Perhaps this is what's being talked about in Matthew 18. Agreement, harmony, symphony. They are the product of humble awareness of how patient and forgiving God was with me, all right, or with you, with all of us. Okay, God is perfect. He made us in his image. We can respond to this in one of two ways, pridefully or humbly. The best ways to respond, humbly. You know, to become this person who desires more than anything to be the person who gives themselves to the Lord and to the Lord's glory in ways that cause God's plans, God's will to be done. All right, and so there's the prime place to be is in humble submission to God, happily and patiently helping people along. And then I'm going to close with this picture from 2 Timothy verses 24 and 26 of chapter 2 in 2 Timothy. The Lord's bondservant must not be quarrelsome, but be kind to all, able to teach, patient when wronged, and with gentleness correcting those who are in opposition or who oppose themselves in King James, if perhaps God may grant them repentance, leading to the knowledge of the truth, and that they may come to their senses and escape from the snare of the devil, having been held captive by him to do his will. It's this kind of place that the prayer of agreement is powerful. With that, I'm going to say God bless you. We'll see you next time on the 10-Minute Summary.